Hello, my name is Guy de la Bédoyère, Roman historian, specialist in Roman Britain, but with a very wide range of interests in anything to do with the Roman Empire. And this is one of my random videos, if you like, to do with the Roman world, which I'm posting on YouTube. And as so often, this is in response to some questions I've been asked. Today's video is about Hadrian's Wall, the huge and unique Roman military frontier in northern Britain. If you're not familiar with it, it runs roughly between where the modern towns of Newcastle and Carlisle are, and it was built by the Emperor Hadrian, but had a very long history and has quite a lot of complicated aspects to it, which I'm going to go through today. So let's just go back to the beginning with the first question, which was, why was Hadrian's Wall built? Very good question, and first of all I have to put that into the broader context. The Romans invaded Britain permanently in the year 43, AD 43, on the orders of the Emperor Claudius, who was the fourth emperor of the Roman world. Now, what Claudius's long-term plan or policy or interest in Britain is, we've got no idea, if indeed he even had one. He was only interested at the time in getting a military conquest so he could hold a triumph in Rome and prove himself as Roman emperor. Nevertheless, the Romans stayed, and over the next four decades or so, the conquest proceeded fairly steadily, apart from the huge interruption of the Boudiccan Revolt in 60 to 61. By the early 80s, the Romans were up in Scotland. Now, this was during the time of the governor Gnaeus Julius Agricola, who had a double tenure as governor between about 78 to 84, and he was the one who spearheaded this major advance right up into the north. And it does look as if, at that stage, the Roman policy was to conquer the whole of Britain. Now, as it happens, the Emperor Domitian, who ruled from 81 to 96, ordered the withdrawal. Not only did he pull out Agricola, he also ordered that those forts were given up, and that was the end. The Romans pulled back from Scotland to really where the north of England is today, and formed a frontier, such as it was, along a road we now call the Stane Gate, which ran roughly between where Newcastle and Carlisle are today. We know very little about Roman policy at that date. There are really no historical sources that we have. There is the remarkable fort of Vindolanda, one of a number of forts along that road, which has produced a huge number of fascinating military documents from the end of the 1st century AD, early 2nd century AD. But they tell us principally about the workings of the fort, how the Roman army was operating in the north there. It doesn't tell us anything really about Roman government policy towards Britain. It's not until we get to the reign of Hadrian 20 years later or so that we do find out a little bit about it. Now, let's just put this into a clearer context about the whole Roman world. The Romans based their entire imperial policy on predation. The Roman Empire did not have venture capital. It did not invest in industry or technological development. Wealth and growth came generally from seizing other provinces, taking bullion in, for example. Long before that, they'd acquired the silver mines in Spain, which had helped finance the Roman army. Trajan, who had ruled between 98 and 117, just before Hadrian, he had conquered Dacia, again bringing a lot of wealth into the Roman world. But this expansion was like inflating a balloon, and it was stretching the resources further and further. And Hadrian came to the conclusion that it was impossible for the Roman world to continue expansion. And he ordered the end of those predatory conquests and really the formalisation of the Roman frontiers. Now, that was going to create all sorts of very serious long-term problems, because the Roman Empire was constructed on this paradox. It had to keep on expanding, but the load of expanding was too much for it. Once it stopped expanding, the seeds, if you like, for decline and decay were sown. But that's later on in the story. Now, as it happens, we do have a historical source that tells us a little bit about why the wall was built. It's in this. It's called the Scriptores Historiae Augustae. It's a series of imperial biographies that were mainly written in the late 3rd, 4th centuries AD, somewhat later. Now, they're not great historical sources compared to, for example, to the earlier Roman historian Tacitus or Cassius Dio, for example. But they do give us a little bit of an idea, and there's the point here is that Hadrian is described as having gone to Germany to investigate the garrison there. Hadrian was a great explorer of the Roman world. He visited all sorts of provinces, but he was a real stickler for military discipline. And he was outraged when he discovered the German garrison officers lolling around with kitchen gardens, relaxing in porticos and having dinner parties. And he ordered all sorts of toughening up. And that's what he did before he went to Britain. And the source that we've got here says, "And so, having reformed the army quite in the manner of a monarch," and that means in Germany, He set out for Britain, and this is in the year 122, and there he corrected many abuses and was the first to construct a wall 80 miles in length, and that's 80 Roman miles, which a Roman mile is slightly shorter than modern mile, so it's about 76 modern miles. And here's the key line, which was to separate the barbarians from the Romans. And the Latin is qui barbarus Romanosque divideret, which I suppose means which divided the barbarians and the Romans. That's a more literal translation. So divideret sounds like divide, and indeed that is what it means, to divide. But in Latin, the word has a stronger force. It really suggests to force apart the barbarians and the Romans. Now, this is quite tricky to understand because, of course, it doesn't give any geographical sense whatsoever about the Britons to the north or the south. It just says to separate the Romans and the barbarians. And one thing about Hadrian's Wall is that it's a very clear Roman military zone. And it's worth bearing in mind that the Britons to the south of the wall, inside the province, well, certainly in the north, were really just as hostile as those beyond the wall. So, in a sense, the Roman frontier that Hadrian had ordered the construction of was going to be something that kept the Romans enclosed in a military zone, protected them from the Britons on either side. Now, it's much more complicated than that even, because it's quite clear that the frontier was porous. It wasn't designed to be a rigid barrier. It was designed to operate in a quite different way. And that helps us to understand a wider range of reasons for why it was being built. And in the first instance, we know it's part of formalising the frontiers. We know it's part of ending imperial expansion. It's pretty obvious that it was going to be a great deal of work for the army, and it's possibly, even very likely, that one of the reasons Hadrian had for the wall being built was not only to protect the area, there had been trouble in that part of Britain, but also to give the Roman army something to do. So, and also to really toughen them up with some hard work, some competitive hard work. Now let's look at the next question. Who built it? Well, the answer to that is really quite simple. Hadrian had arrived in Britain in 122 with somebody called Aulus Plutorius Nepos, a senior senator who he made governor of Britain, and they brought with them the 6th Legion Victrix. Now, the 6th Legion had come to replace the 9th, which had either been withdrawn from Britain or disappeared in battle. That remains a mystery. Nobody really knows what happened to it. It was last attested at York in Trajan's reign, but is really more or less never heard of again. Now, the inscriptions that are found on Hadrian's Wall make it absolutely clear that 3 legions were involved. The 6th Victrix, which had just arrived, and the 2nd Augusta, and the 20th Valeria Victrix, 2 legions that had been in Britain right from the earliest days, from the original conquest in 43 under Claudius. And the inscriptions which have been found along the wall show that under Aulus Plutorius Nepos, these legions began the construction. Now, they were overseeing the work as well as doing it, probably a lot of forced labour, and perhaps some of the provincial auxiliary soldiers helping out as well. And it's possible, stylistically, to recognise the work of the different legions because they built some of the components of the wall in slightly different ways. Of course, Hadrian himself, and here he is on a sestertius struck in Rome, he may well have had a part in designing the wall, and that's quite an interesting idea. We know he had a great deal of architectural interest, and he'd actually been there and seen the place for himself. How did it work? Now, there is a very fascinating story. The wall was conceived originally as a 10-foot wide, and this is known as the Broad Wall. We don't know the height because no bit of it has ever survived to its full height, full original height. It was conceived as a wall that would run from where Newcastle is today, which was called Pons Aelius, the Aelian Bridge, named after Hadrian. And it would run all the way west to the River Irthing, roughly in the middle of northern England, as a stone wall. And from there on, it would be constructed in turf onto a bonus on Solway. Now, the wall as it was originally designed was going to be a curtain, a wall curtain with a forward ditch. There would be a fortified gateway every Roman mile, approximately, And that's called today a mile castle. And these are gateways through the wall, but they are little fortifications, and it's clearly designed for supervision. And between each mile castle, there were two turrets, two lookout towers, every roughly third of a mile. So it's pretty obvious it was designed for visual communications along the wall, but it's also clear from the mile castles that this was designed to supervise and corral movement rather than stop it altogether. Who was let through? We don't know. But it's likely that existing trade routes, existing people movements were allowed to pass through the wall, but they were always going to be supervised by Roman soldiers who would therefore be able to exact tribute or tax from them, check that they weren't carrying weapons, prevent them from organising themselves into large groups. And that is probably the basis of the idea of how the wall was going to operate. That sounds great, doesn't it? And that's how it was started under Hadrian. Now, very shortly after construction began, they changed the idea. And we can see that because although the soldiers were already laying out the 10-foot wide foundation, they switched to an 8-foot thick wall, and they built that on some of the pre-prepared 10-foot wide foundations. And they continue there with what is now called the narrow wall. Now that's the stone wall, as I said, going up to the River Irthing, and then from the west on it was constructed in turf to begin with. And as they went along, the legions that were responsible for the various components like the mile castles did erect inscriptions, some of which have survived, that show us what was happening at that date. But again, not very long after that, the decision was made to put forts on the wall. Full-size auxiliary forts, not legionaries. These are the auxiliary provincial troops that are moved up to the wall. And a whole series of forts are built, for example, Benwell, which is a cavalry fort right up on a hill towards the east. And then there's the cavalry fort at Chester's in Roman times called Caelernum. And then beyond that, there is Housesteads, Vercovicium, and a whole series of other forts. And they are sometimes cavalry forts, sometimes infantry forts. And the remarkable thing is that it's so clear that the plans were changing as they went along that where Housesteads fort was built, they actually had to knock down a section of the wall with one of the turrets that had already been constructed. And if you go and visit Housesteads today, you can see that section of wall which has been exposed to public view, and it's within the fort compound. Another decision was made to build something called the Vallum to the south of the wall. Now the Vallum is a very large ditch with mounds on either side, and this was clearly designed to fortify the military zone to the south. It looks as if there must have been a significant threat from some Britons in the communities in the hinterland of the wall to the south, and the Vallum was built absolutely religiously right the way across behind Hadrian's wall. And even then, within all that, they still change the plans, and what happens is another fort, for example at Carrobrough, is inserted on the wall between Chester's and Housesteads, and that involves actually burying some of the vallum that had just been dug. Now this is all happening within the space of about 10 to 13 years after the wall is initial construction is ordered. And it's pretty obvious that the wall was not only evolving, it's changing ideas, but the wall itself is probably not even finished at this date. Under Hadrian's successor, Antoninus Pius, another wall is built to the north between Glasgow and Edinburgh, where they are today, and that's called the Antonine Wall. It's only occupied for about 20 years. During that time, Hadrian's wall is semi-mothballed and then comes back into commission later. So we can forget about the Antonine Wall, really. It's a very briefly occupied frontier. And when the Romans come back to Hadrian's Wall, more work is done to complete it, and it's probably around that stage in the mid to later second century that the western sector from the Irthing is then replaced. The turf wall is replaced and built in stone. As it happens, we have a pretty good idea of what Hadrian's Wall was called in antiquity. It was called the Vallum Ili, the frontier of Ilius, Ilius being Hadrian's nomen. His full name was Publius Ilius Hadrianus. And this has been found on a little souvenir bronze cup that's been found in Staffordshire. It's called the Ilum Cup. It lists a number of the forts round the wall, and it says Rigore Valle Ili, strictly according to the order of the forts on the Ilian frontier. And so we now know that that's what it was called. And the word vallum actually means frontier. We apply it today to the ditch to the back of the wall, but in fact in antiquity vallum meant the whole frontier. And one Roman inscription even refers to transvallum, which is an operation beyond the wall. Now, let's not also forget that there were forts to the south of the wall and also to the north, for example, like High Rochester and Risingham and Biron's and Bewcastle. These were outpost forts. There's also a big supply base at South Shields, and I shouldn't forget to mention that the plan had also been changed to extend the wall further east out to Wall's End, which is called Wall's End today, out in the eastern outskirts of Newcastle upon Tyne. And it sounds as if the wall began there. It hadn't originally, but there is, you know, there is a fort. Segedunum is the name of the fort there, but actually it's a later addition. And there's also a whole series of outpost structures and military fortifications around the Solway coast beyond the end of the wall. So it's a massively complex structure with a whole series of forts. Who lived there? Well, this is a very interesting question as well. We know from inscriptions that there were various units installed in the forts along the wall. For example, the first cohort of Elians. There's the first cohort of Tungrians at Housesteads, for example. There are various ethnic units. These are generally speaking in nominally 1,000-strong units. In fact, in reality, it's more like 800 or 900 or half that size. These are not legions. These are auxiliary provincial troops, usually identified by ethnic titles, such as Gauls or Asturians. And these did change over time. One of the common cliches is to suggest that the Roman army was made up of very specifically identifiable ethnic units in the provincial auxiliary army. And that possibly was true to some extent to begin with, but it's really very clear actually that these ethnic identities are pretty nebulous actually, because the soldiers did recruit men from all over the Roman world. We know this from various contexts, and the best example I can cite to you is not actually a soldier from Hadrian's Wall, but one who was stationed at Cirencester in Gloucestershire in the first century. Sextus Valerius Genialis served as a cavalry trooper with a Thracian unit, but he actually tells us on his tombstone that he was Frisian from northwestern Europe. And the historian Cassius Dio even tells us that units of cavalry were sometimes labelled Batavian because Batavians were supposed to be such great horsemen. In other words, they applied the ethnic title because it sounded good. So the other thing is, of course, is that when these soldiers were based in these locations for a long time, as they acquired local wives or brought wives with them, they had children. Some of the sons would proceed to go on and join the Roman army, perhaps even serve in the same unit. And such ethnic identity as had ever been part of that unit became progressively more and more diluted. And in any case, as I've mentioned, there is no doubt about the fact from a number of inscriptions that soldiers were hired from almost anywhere to join the unit, regardless of their individual ethnic identity and the nominal ethnic identity of the Roman unit that was there. So, and we know from the various inscriptions that there were families along the wall, there were children, these were military communities, and they lived a full and varied life, which even involved, there are towns and settlements that grow up around all the forts. These are being increasingly well understood with geophysics and aerial photography. This is showing that around each of the forts on Hadrian's Wall were often quite extensive areas of settlement, and the inscriptions record this, and even to some extent local government operating within these communities. There are temples, there are traders, there are all sorts of services being operated there, and the wall lasts for a very long time in that context. What happened to it? Well, we know that with Hadrian's Wall that it really lasts throughout the rest of the province's history, which takes us over a period of 300 years. And to put that into context, 300 years back from now would take us to the reign of George I in the early 18th century. So it's a long period of time. And we shouldn't be surprised that whatever original purpose there was for Hadrian's Wall when it was built, different purposes must have arisen as it went on. We know that various facilities or features of the wall were blocked, augmented, changed over the period of time. It's clear that the way it operated was being altered, but we know relatively little about that. What we do know from some historical sources is that there are major incursions from time to time. For example, in 184, during the reign of Commodus, there is a massive invasion across the wall. A great deal of damage is done, and a governor called Ulpius Marcellus has to go up there and sort everything out. And later on, not very long after that, actually, Septimius Severus comes to Britain in the early 3rd century. He fights a campaign in Scotland. He tries to renew the conquest of Scotland, and he has to rebuild Hadrian's Wall and repair it. In fact, in the 18th the 19th centuries, some people believed that the wall had been originally built by Severus. He'd had to do so much work to repair it that he effectively put his own stamp on it. And it's worth bearing in mind, actually, that the Roman architect Vitruvius tells us that the type of wall that Hadrian's Wall was, although he wrote much earlier, but he was describing the way that sort of wall was built, was quick and efficient, but it was prone to falling down because although it had dressed facing stones, it had a rubble core with puddled concrete. And of course, on Hadrian's Wall, the water gets in, it turns into ice in the winter, off pop the facing stones, and the wall is very badly damaged. So Hadrian's Wall, in fact, had to be constantly repaired, even during antiquity. And to this day, in fact, the stretches of Hadrian's Wall that you can see are largely restored from the stones lying around because the style of construction was not particularly reliable. Now, after Severus, there is a fairly long period of peace and quiet, right up until the end of the 3rd century and into the early 4th. Then an emperor called Constantius Chlorus, one of a college of emperors known as the Tetrarchy, he arrives in Britain and he campaigns in the north. And we also know that the two senior emperors in that arrangement, Diocletian and Maximian, are commemorated on inscriptions from a couple of forts on the wall, showing that yet again there is major reconstruction work. It's all a bit rhetorical in the way it describes the way buildings are completely collapsed and covered in earth, and they may have been exaggerated that, but it's fairly obvious that the wall was pretty run down at that stage and they'd had to do a lot of rebuilding. During the 4th century, to put that into a sort of broader historical context, that's the so-called golden age of the Roman villas to the south, like Chedworth or Lullingstone, for example. That's the area of the flash mosaic floors and wall plaster and those very elaborate country houses and some of the great Roman treasure hoards that have been found in Britain. Meanwhile, up on Hadrian's Wall, this remote military frontier, you've got long-established communities. The architectural structures on the wall are becoming rather faded and run down. And in 367, there is a massive barbarian conspiracy. There's a huge invasion across the wall and also onto the coasts. And somebody called Count Theodosius has to be sent to Britain in order to sort out the desperate problems in Britain and recover the situation. And from there on, Hadrian's Wall is increasingly, I suppose, fading into the background. There's a series of usurper emperors in that period, and the two most important are Magnus Maximus, between 383 to 388, and then the notorious Constantine III from 407 to 11. They're not the only ones, but these men, they withdraw a large number of soldiers from Britain's garrison, take them off to the continent, and they denude the garrison of Britain. And it's in 410 that effectively government of Britain is given up by the Roman Empire. And we know from the archaeology of places like the fort at Burd Oswald is that these places become extremely run down, and they may even have become the basis of, I suppose, if you like, chieftains, possibly the descendants of officers in the units who were still nominally based there, really just controlling the local landscape, effectively with no overall authority. But it's very difficult to know because at that time, into the 5th century, no coinage comes into Britain, pottery ceases manufacture. The archaeology is very challenging, but some crucial work has been done at the fort of Burd Oswald that does suggest that some of the buildings in the fort had become like a chieftain's headquarters. But they're really the story fades away. It pops up again, Hadrian's Wall pops up again in Bede, the Anglo-Saxon chronicler who lived in Jarrow in what we now call the Dark Ages, and he describes Hadrian's Wall being still quite an impressive monument. Much later on, the forts had become, by the 16th or 17th century, the headquarters of cattle thieves, weavers as they were known. Some of the forts, at any rate, had become that. It was a wild and lawless part of Britain at that time. And It's really only during the late 18th and early 19th century that Hadrian's Wall starts to excite the attention of the antiquarians, the early historians, people who are beginning to take a very serious interest in how Britain's past had been, and they were particularly fascinated by classical monuments. And various things appear. For example, this is an 1880s copy of John Collingwood Bruce's Handbook to the Roman Wall. And this was designed as a book that would take you all the way along the wall, exploring each of the forts. It's got various engravings and things. It's all terribly very pro-Roman as conquerors. It's very Victorian in the sense of seeing imperialists as great and good things. But this effectively is like an early guidebook. And it's carried right on up to modern times. This is my own 1980s copy. It's based on Collingwood Bruce's original one. And it's got my own notes and things all the way along the wall. Now, the wall was being systematically stripped in the 19th century by farmers and other people for the stone. But once the antiquarians get interested in it and they start to buy some of the land or investigate it archaeologically, the wall becomes preserved, at least what's left of it. And they begin to realise just how much has gone. For example, Lanercost Priory in Cumbria, that was built largely out of stone from the wall in the Middle Ages. The antiquarians see to it that places are preserved, the excavations begin, this is when the inscriptions start to be uncovered, there's a great deal more exploration of the sites, and the whole story of the wall begins to be uncovered. And of course the fascinating thing about Hadrian's Wall is that that story is still being uncovered. I had the privilege of being able to write my own book about Hadrian's Wall. This is A Guide and a History, which I wrote a number of years ago, and I suppose it takes the story of the wall as the history and background to it, but also takes you along the wall from east to west, where you can pick up and drop this wherever you want as you go along visiting the various locations. It is, of course, an absolutely fascinating place to visit, and there are some wonderful museums in Carlisle and Newcastle that preserve some of the inscriptions, and also at the fort at Chester's. Many of the forts are in ownership and public bodies like English Heritage, or, for example, owned by local councils in Newcastle, so that you can visit the wall at the fort at Wall's End and also at South Shields and explore this. And I've given you some of the ideas and background to Hadrian's Wall. I don't want you to think in any way that this is definitive or finished or that there are all the answers. There are some great experts working along the wall, continuing to explore and investigate and finding new things all the time. But it remains one of the most interesting Roman military monuments ever constructed. We're very lucky to have it in Britain. It is something of a swine to visit in the winter because the weather can be pretty vile, and sometimes I can assure you in the summer, and I went to university at Durham and often used to visit the wall there in May or June, and I can tell you could still get horizontal rain boring its way through you even at that time of the year. But that only kind of makes for the magnificence of the landscape. So I hope that's answered some of your questions or thoughts about Hadrian's Wall and how it worked, that it'll inspire you perhaps to go and visit it for yourself if you haven't done so already. Thank you very much.